Welcome to Baikumi. Today we're going to be making the Japanese version of the potato croquette. Typically the Japanese version adds meat, but today we're going to be making ours vegetarian. This dish can be enjoyed on its own, but personally, I love to serve mine with curry. Let's get started. Please find the ingredients and tools at the end of this video and the recipe on baikumi.com. First, defrost some peas and corn. Take a half cup frozen peas and place in a small colander. Take a half cup frozen corn and place into the same colander. Now, rinse under cool water to help thaw and set aside to drain. Also, set out one egg to bring to room temperature. This helps prevent the egg from cooking when adding it to the hot potatoes later on. Next, peel and mince one medium or large clove of garlic and set aside. Breaking the clove triggers a reaction, increasing the healthy compounds and limiting damage from heat. But it needs to sit for about 10 minutes. Peel and dice one small onion. You can use white, yellow, or sweet. Grab a medium-sized fry pan and add about 1 tablespoon of oil or butter. I like using butter for additional flavor. Turn on the stove to medium, and then add the onion. Cook until soft but not brown. Feel free to sprinkle in kosher salt and ground black pepper for flavor. I'm only adding the pepper since I'm using butter for frying. And turn down the stove if necessary so the onions don't burn. Try a piece of onion to check for doneness, if unsure. The onions will continue to cook in the pan, so slightly undercooked is okay. Then set aside when finished. It's time for the potatoes. Rinse and peel about 3 pounds of russet potatoes. This should equal about 6 cups of cubed potatoes using a liquid measuring cup. Use the potato eye remover when necessary. Cube into approximately 1/2 inch by 1/2 inch pieces. The actual size isn't as important as cutting the same size. The goal is to have the potatoes finish cooking at the same time. Continue to cube, and don't worry if you have a little more or a little less than 6 cups or 3 pounds of potatoes. I started with 3 1/4 pounds, which is going to give me about 7+ cups of potatoes. I love this recipe because it's pretty forgiving. When finished, it's time to move back to the stove. Grab a 5-quart pot and fill it with enough water to cover the potatoes completely. Turn on the stove to high and heavily salt the water. When the water begins to boil, add the potatoes and cook until tender. Stir once in a while so no potatoes stick to the pot. After about 10 minutes of boiling, check with a skewer or toothpick for doneness. The skewer should pierce the potato easily, or I just find trying a piece the easiest. When finished cooking, drain the water completely. Use a colander in the sink, or I like to use what is technically a splatter screen held against the pot. Now move quickly to mash the hot potatoes. Either in a large mixing bowl or the same 5-quart pot, mash the potatoes with a fork or a potato masher. Work until the texture is smooth. It's finally time to combine all the ingredients. Add the garlic, add 1/2 teaspoon kosher salt. Diamond Crystal kosher salt is definitely worth purchasing. Add 1/2 teaspoon ground black pepper, add the peas and corn, add the onion. Lightly beat the egg before adding, and after adding the egg, mix immediately and thoroughly. Yay, we're finally ready to form small slider-sized patties, each about 3/4 inch thick. There should be close to 24 by the end of this. Place the patties on large plates or baking sheets without overcrowding or stacking. Okay, it looks like I have 26 patties. Now prepare a batter by adding 3 or 4 heaping tablespoons of rice flour to a bowl. I'm just using a flatware soup spoon for this. And please use the non-glutinous rice flour from the Asian market. Bob's Red Mill may seem a bit gritty. Add 1/4 cup of liquid to form a pancake-like batter, adding more liquid if necessary. I'm using oat milk, but other non-dairy milk substitutes or regular milk or water in a pinch can be used. Continue to adjust the batter until you have the right consistency. And finally, pour some panko in a separate bowl. Now dip one patty in the batter and coat completely. Then cover with panko all over. And set aside on a large plate or baking sheet. Be careful not to overcrowd or stack. Continue with the remaining patties, making more batter when necessary. And now we're done and ready to deep fry. But first, let's freeze any extras at this point because this is quite a lot of food. To do this, use a freezer-safe container and separate any layers with wax or parchment paper. Yes, you can stack the patties at this point. Allow to cool completely before placing the patties in the freezer to avoid as much frost from forming as possible. When ready to enjoy, fry the patties straight out of the freezer. Just be careful because any frost or ice crystals on the food will cause the hot oil to splatter more than usual. Okay, now we're really ready to deep fry. Fill a heavy gauge pot with a neutral flavored oil to about 1 inch deep. I'm using a 3-quart pot to conserve oil. This is refined coconut oil, which does not have flavor like virgin coconut oil. Coconut oil stands up to heat really well and has great results. Turn on the stove to medium high. An extra baking sheet on the back burner helps with cleanup, and prepare a baking sheet lined with a paper towel and a cooling rack that fits on top. This helps drain the oil and keeps the patties crispy and crunchy while cooling. The oil is ready when a piece of panko floats to the top and bubbles quickly. This is definitely not ready. Let's try this again, and this time, the oil is ready. Now add the patties carefully without overcrowding. Let fry undisturbed in the beginning, and then check to be sure that the patties are not stuck to the bottom of the pot. Turn the patties over to cook evenly, and take out any that are nicely golden in color. Add another batch of patties and continue until finished. Remove any stray panko from the bottom of the pot with a skimmer. If left, the panko may burn, ruining the flavor of the oil and your food. When finished, turn off the stove and remove the pot from the hot burner to cool the oil safely. Now you're ready to eat. Enjoy! Thanks so much for watching, and as always, for more information or a printable recipe, visit bykumi.com. And don't forget to share your photos. We'll see you again soon. 짜잔! The ingredients today: russet potatoes, frozen peas, frozen corn, eggs, kosher salt, ground black pepper, garlic, small onion, neutral flavored oil or butter for frying the onion, non-glutinous rice flour available at Asian markets, non-dairy milk substitute or regular milk, panko, Japanese style breadcrumbs, neutral flavored oil for deep frying, and finally, serve with A1 sauce or store-bought katsu sauce, or make your own using 3 tablespoons of ketchup and 1 to 2 teaspoons of Worcestershire sauce. And for the tools, small bowl and colander. Use this bowl to also lightly beat the egg, or I grabbed a measuring cup, measuring spoons, measuring cups, vegetable peeler, cutting board and knife, large measuring cup, spatula, cooking chopsticks or tongs, and a resting plate, medium fry pan, large cooking spoon and a resting plate, skewer or a toothpick, 5-quart pot, large mixing bowl and a colander if not using the 5-quart pot and a splatter screen, potato masher, fork and a soup spoon, 1 bowl for the panko and 1 for the batter, large plates or baking sheets, baking sheet lined with a paper towel and a cooling rack that fits on top, 3-quart heavy gauge pot, skimmer with a resting plate, wax paper, freezer safe container, serving plate.